This is the story of Germany's oldest university and its honorary professor, Pan Jian-Wei, also known as China's father of quantum. It takes us into the nexus of academic freedom and national security.
Technologies should not be divided into military and civilian. We just need to find their rightful applications.
The way to think about this is really what kind of work University of Heidelberg wants to be engaged in, regardless of where that work is taking place.
Should we just say, let's stop all basic research? Let's stop asking questions about nature?
Heidelberg hosts many top scientists carrying out groundbreaking work. Little did they know how they would become entangled in China's quantum strategy. So the question is, should German universities collaborate with quantum scientists who are accountable to an authoritarian state? In 2019, a private U.S. intelligence firm published a damning report. It claimed that China is systematically exploiting quantum research at Western universities for the benefit of its own military.
Pan Jian-Wei developed and leads this strategy. Heidelberg University is arguably the most important foreign partner behind China's rapid progress in dual-use quantum technologies.
Dual-use technologies can be used in both civilian and military applications. Professor Pan is indeed the driving force behind China's quantum strategy. He's been collaborating with Germany's Heidelberg University on quantum research for two decades. Let's explore the origins of this collaboration. Heidelberg is home to Germany's oldest university, established in the 14th century. It's one of the top universities in the country. The Physics Institute is renowned for its basic research in quantum physics. Emerging quantum technologies are set to revolutionize how we do business, share information, and fight future wars. These technologies will transform our digital lives, potentially even surpassing the impact of the internet as we know it today.
Quantum technology is a key technology. It's hard to disagree with that. We really want to understand quantum physics first, and we still have a long way to go with that, and then carry that knowledge forward for the benefit of society. But that's not what we're doing here. Our focus is basic research. As for the technological applications, to be honest, that's a bit outside my area of expertise.
When we think about a field that is emerging technologies like quantum communications and quantum encryption, the future is not predetermined. The path is still contingent.
Chinese quantum physicist Pan Jian-Wei moved to Heidelberg in 2003. Europe provided him with more opportunities to explore the cutting-edge field of quantum communication.
Quantum communication ensures secure transmission that is resistant to hacking and surveillance. It can be applied in national defense, administration, and finance. It can also protect individuals.
Pan's work in Heidelberg was crowned with all the major science prizes and close to 5 million euros in funding from Germany and the EU.
He's won practically all the grants anyone could possibly win. That's how he financed his research in Heidelberg.
Back then, Europe, and especially Germany, had begun to seek out China as a major trading partner. This prompted a boost in scientific collaboration, driven also by political considerations.
Pan Jian-Wei was always interested in fundamental questions and in figuring out how all of this could be used to develop new technologies. The central question, of course, was how to achieve secure communications and over what distances they could be used.
Professor Pan often went back home to teach and to recruit young Chinese quantum talents for his Heidelberg research group. They too received funding. Then came 2008. Pan packed his bags and returned home to his alma mater, the University of Science and Technology of China, or USTC. He took many of his Chinese students with him and transferred his lab equipment and projects to China. Given the current political climate, it's hard to understand how a move like this could have been pulled off.
To me, it seems like with all these new export controls and the like, this would be practically impossible. Worldviews have shifted somewhat, and of course, we had to accept that.
Since Professor Pan's departure from Heidelberg, China has regularly announced major breakthroughs in the field of quantum communication. In 2016, his team launched the world's first quantum satellite into space. A short time later, they used the satellite to establish the first tap-proof video conference. We asked Professor Pan for an interview. He agreed to a written exchange.
Despite the fact that quantum information technology still has a long way to go before it can be widely adopted, I firmly believe that these emerging technologies will ultimately bring broad benefits to human society.
But quantum technology also harbors a dark side that holds the potential to undermine human rights.
I would like to emphasize that any scientific discovery and technology may have dual use. This is not an aspect that a scientist can control or predict.
Let's delve into what this dilemma might entail. Professor Pan is the co-founder of Quantum CTEC, one of China's leading quantum communication companies. In 2017, Quantum CTEC opened a branch in China's Xinjiang region, where at least 1 million Muslim Uyghurs have been arbitrarily detained. We discovered a webinar posted online in which Quantum CTEC explained their services. Access to this video has since been restricted.
The defense challenge we face in Xinjiang for information safety is significant. Quantum communication technology has the potential to address it effectively.
And indeed, there have been major data leaks from the region that have revealed the scope of China's persecution of the Uyghur people.
Especially some hostile forces in the West challenge our information security by attempting to steal our internal information. With quantum technology, we can safeguard the security of our information and greatly support the overall goal of a stable and lasting security for our society.
We asked Professor Pan about the activities of the Xinjiang branch. This was his response.
After the early period of founding the company and implementing the technology transfer, I have been no longer involved in managing the company since 2011, except for being a shareholder.
The fact that the company was permitted to open a branch in such a highly militarized zone suggests that it has ties to the Chinese security state. Quantum CTEC did not respond to our questions.
Seems to be very much aligned with the strategic and security aims of the state. I think for any individual or entity to facilitate or work with institutions of state violence is morally dubious at best, and to contribute to institutions and instruments of state oppression is always morally apprehensible.
Dr. Yangyang Cheng is a physicist who began her career at China's prestigious University of Science and Technology, just like Professor Pan. But while Pan chose to return to China, she decided to move to the United States.
Scientists often are driven by an intellectual curiosity and out of a certain political ignorance or just moral apathy, or just out of a preference to preserve their relationship with the state, with funding agencies, that they choose to overlook or not think as much about the social cost and the political and moral implications of their work.
Back to Professor Pan. Documents we obtained showed that after his departure from Heidelberg, cooperation continued just as before. Pan was almost immediately appointed an honorary professor. Academic exchange of quantum researchers was ongoing, and there were plans for a joint quantum center in China. There's also another mastermind behind this partnership. Meet Matthias Vitamula. The German quantum physicist is an advocate of joint research with China.
As a scientist, you often feel like a deer that wants to avoid the spotlight. You want to do your research and putter away on your own.
In 2013, Vitamula joined USTC under a Chinese state-sponsored program that invites pioneering scientists to conduct research in China.
What really intrigued me was the opportunity to witness firsthand how science, and especially quantum physics, operates there.
Other scientists turned down such offers, sometimes citing concerns about academic freedom and security. After his five-year contract expired, Vitamula was almost immediately appointed an honorary professor at USTC, just like Pan Jian-Wei in Heidelberg.
I believe it was, and still is important, to understand the developments in China. What we're proud of, I believe, is the kind of mutual understanding that develops. There is an exchange of ideas, and we gain a better understanding of how science operates in the other country.
But in November 2021, the U.S. sanctioned the Chinese lab where both Vitamula and Pan have been carrying out their research. And remember Quantum C-Tech? The company co-founded by Professor Pan? It got sanctioned along with the lab. The two entities were blacklisted for their alleged attempts to acquire American technology to help China develop quantum applications for its military. In short, they were sanctioned on the grounds of national security.
Well, it's not something you can just ignore. We can't stay in our ivory tower and shut our eyes to this.
But despite the sanctions, collaboration has continued. Heidelberg University insists the work is fully transparent and focused on basic research.
We are studying the fundamental workings of the natural world. Of course, as we've seen in the case of quantum physics, what we learn can eventually end up having practical applications. How could these concerns be resolved? I don't think it's possible, I'm afraid. Should we just say, let's stop all basic research? Let's stop being curious? Stop asking questions about the natural world? Should we just abandon our efforts at international collaboration and exchange?
Germany's oldest university continues to stand by its partnership with Professor Pan. But global politics has taken a turn. China was once seen as a desirable partner, but now Germany and the EU view it as a systemic rival.
Anyone who listens to China knows with what self-confidence it will decisively influence the development of our world. More repressive internally, more offensive externally. China has changed, and that's why our China policy must also change.
The German government has just released its first ever national China strategy. The negotiations took months of heated debate behind closed doors. The paper also addresses the science community.
China's military-civil fusion policy is placing limits on our cooperation. We are taking into account the fact that civilian research projects, including basic research, are also being considered by China in strategic terms with respect to their military use.
But Germany's constitution protects scientific freedom, placing ultimate responsibility on the universities and scientists themselves. So, where does that leave us? In addition to Professor Pan, 11 other Chinese quantum researchers trained in Heidelberg currently work at USTC. What's more, Professor Pan and USTC have signed quantum research collaborations with big state-owned defense companies.
The Chinese government has actually been learning from the US government, which has been doing, in effect, civil military fusion for decades and very successfully from a state's perspective.
In his written statement to us, Professor Pan explicitly affirms that none of his projects have received any form of military support since his return from Germany.
Even though certain technologies might have military uses, it's not something that any scientist can control or predict. What really matters is that I'm committed to advancing knowledge and creativity to help people and society as best as possible.
China wants to have the most advanced army in the world by 2049. And quantum technology plays a crucial role in their plans.
So it's not so much about whether a German institution can collaborate with a Chinese institution, but really what kind of work. Once it is created, once this application has been developed, there is no way to put the genie back into the bottle.
So, should German universities collaborate with scientists who are accountable to an authoritarian state? In any case, the German government and Heidelberg University are reluctant to draw a red line when it comes to basic quantum research with China.